Now that we know how to get access to FCurves, let's talk about how to add, remove, and modify keyframes using those FCurves. Here we have a single FCurve, which is assigned to the animation node for a camera's roll property. Currently it's empty, so let's add some keys. As we've said before, a key has both time and value, and so we'll need to call keyAdd, passing in a local time and a value. There's a value of 0 at frame 0. And here's another key. And as you can see, they can be inserted in any order. And if there's already a key at the time you specify, that key will be replaced by the new key. FBFCurve has a property called keys, which is a list of FBFCurve key objects, one for each keyframe. When you add a keyframe, the keyAdd method returns the index of the newly inserted key. Of course, you can also iterate over the keys list. Now just for fun, here's a sine wave. Now let's say that we want to remove some of these keys. There are a couple of methods we can use: key delete by index range and key delete by time range. To use key delete by index range, you specify an inclusive range of indices, meaning that the start and end keys will be deleted as well. To delete a single key, you can simply pass the same index for both arguments. This function doesn't perform any bounds checking, so MotionBuilder will crash if you supply an invalid frame range. If necessary, you should check for yourself that these values are valid. When you're dealing with indices, it's important to realize that any given index is only valid for as long as the list of keys stays exactly the same. We can illustrate this by trying to delete every other key in the curve. Each time we delete a key, all the keys behind it, that is to the right, have their index reduced by 1, and that affects our iteration. One way to avoid this problem is simply to work from the back of the list. You can also delete keys by specifying a time range. You pass in FB time objects for your start and stop times, and the third argument is a Boolean that determines whether the range is inclusive. So for example, to keep all of the keys up to 2 seconds into the take and throw everything else away, you can write something like this. Finally, to remove all of the keys from an FCurve, you can also use the EditClear method. As we've already seen, we can use an FCurve's keys list to access its individual key objects. Now, as you're probably aware, keyframes are more complicated than just times and values. They also contain information describing how to interpolate between them. It can be a bit tricky here to understand all the interrelated effects of all the different interpolation properties, so let's take a closer look. No matter how our keys are configured, the curve will always pass through the keyframes we've set. Interpolation only affects the area between any two keys. Each key has interpolation properties for its left and right side. The piece of the curve between two keys is defined by the left key's right side settings and the right key's left side settings. The most fundamental property is the interpolation mode itself. Setting a key's interpolation mode tells the FCurve what strategy to use to get from that key to the next one. There are three interpolation modes defined by the FB interpolation enumeration. The simplest is linear, which has no additional settings to configure. Next is constant interpolation, which holds on the key without any transition. The only additional setting that affects a constant key is the constant mode. In normal mode, the curve holds on the key's value until the next key is reached. In next mode, the curve immediately jumps to the next key's value and holds there. Now, the most common interpolation mode, and the most complicated, is cubic. Cubic mode uses piecewise Bezier curves. Basically, you're given control of a couple of handles that you can drag to define the tangent at the given key. These tangents on the left and right side of the key dictate the angle, or the slope, at which the curve will enter and exit the keyframe. The left and right tangents can be set to different angles, which we'd call a break. Additionally, each tangent can be assigned a weight in order to move its control point in or out. MotionBuilder allows the user to modify tangents in a number of ways, called tangent modes. The oddball of these four modes is TCB, which allows the user to set tension, continuity, and bias values. The other three modes deal directly with Bezier tangents. In auto mode, the tangents are calculated automatically based on an option in the FCurve settings. Moving keys around will cause auto tangents to be automatically updated. Tweaking a tangent manually will set it to user mode, meaning that its value is fixed. Finally, break mode is the same as user mode, but with different tangent values for each side of the key. These different tangent modes and their associated properties may seem overly complex, but they really only make a difference to the user. As far as the shape of the curve is concerned, there are only two properties that really matter: derivative and weight. The derivative is the slope of the tangent, expressed in units per second. Basically, if you extend the tangent line until you've gone 1 second forward in x, the derivative is equal to the change in value in y. If you have a tangent line that forms an angle theta between 0 and 90 degrees, then your derivative is equal to the tangent of that angle. So let's say that we want to serialize an F-curve. That is, we want to create a data structure that distills all of the information necessary to describe the curve, so that we can recreate it later. We could store an F-curve as an ordered list of dictionaries, each one representing a single key. For each key, we first need to include the time, value, and interpolation mode. After that, not all of these properties are relevant to all interpolation types, but some of them can be. For instance, even if a key is set to constant or linear interpolation, it can still have a left tangent. Since there's no harm in accessing and setting these properties, there's no need to complicate our code with a bunch of conditionals. Once we populate the list with all of this data for each key, we have a simple Python data structure that completely describes the original F-curve. We can use this data later on to reconstruct the curve. Of course, FBFCurve's key replace by method lets you copy keys from one curve to another, but this approach lets us do a few other handy things. As one example, we can easily write our serialized data structure to a file and use it later in a completely different scene. Now that we know how to serialize keyframe data, turning around and deserializing that data back into actual keys is pretty straightforward. We just have to be careful to do things in a particular order. For one, since the tangents can depend on the positions of adjacent keys, we need to set our keys up in two passes. In the first pass, we add all the keys and set their interpolation mode, tangent mode, and constant mode. There is one concession that we're making here. Since we're not storing tension, continuity, and bias values for our keys, we can't use the TCB tangent mode. However, the derivatives that we saved will produce exactly the same shape. We just have to use break tangent mode in place of TCB. This keeps our data structure nice and homogeneous, and it also makes our code simpler. Once the keys are all in place, we perform a second pass in order to set up the tangents. As a final step, we can modify our function so that it doesn't set the tangent weights unless they've been changed from the default value. This isn't strictly necessary, it just keeps the UI from unlocking the tangent weights on every single key, which might get annoying for the user. Now, just to prove that these functions work, we can copy our animation from one F-curve to another. Serializing data is a useful concept in general. But whether or not you use this code in practice, I hope it helps to illustrate how MotionBuilder stores animation data and what all those properties boil down to. If you don't fully understand it yet, play around with this example code and see how you can manipulate the F-curve data by changing different properties. And until next time, thanks for watching.